The Council on Chemical Abuse, Drug and Alcohol Update on BCTV is supported by the Council on Chemical Abuse.
Council on Chemical Abuse Drug and Alcohol Update on BCTV is supported by the Council on Chemical Abuse.
Hello, and welcome to the Council on Chemical Abuse Drug and Alcohol Update. My name is Yvonne Stroman. I'm the Community Program Specialist at the Council on Chemical Abuse. Glad you could join us today. The Council on Chemical Abuse is Berks County's single county authority. We are responsible for the planning of prevention, treatment, intervention, and recovery services. We help to coordinate those efforts so that people suffering from the disease of addiction have the best chance to recover and sustain long-term sobriety. This is the age of social media. Engaging in various forms of social media is a routine activity that research has shown to benefit children and adolescents by enhancing communication, social connection, and even technical skills. Social media sites allow teens to accomplish online many tasks that are important to them offline, staying connected with friends and family, making new friends, sharing pictures, and exchanging ideas. However, in some instances, using social media can be a risk to adolescents more often than most adults realize. Most risks fall into the following categories, such as peer-to-peer pressure, inappropriate content on social media, lack of understanding the online privacy issues, and outside influence of the third-party advertising groups. And of course, the list can go on and on. Because of their limited capacity for self-regulation and susceptibility to peer pressure, youth and adults are at some form of risk as they navigate and experiment with social media. So today our program is to raise awareness and educate our caregivers and parents about the pros and cons of social media and how we do that for our young people in the classrooms to educate and raise their own awareness about the benefits of social media, but also what might be some of the harms that are lurking within our social media websites. To join me is probably in community of Berks, man of many hats, as I like to call him, but Mike Reese. Mike is a longtime friend of mine. He also is a co-worker with me at the Council on Chemical Abuse. And so I've asked him to join me today because he's in the schools, talking with our middle school and high school students about social media. So we're going to talk about teens and technology today and how the possibility of overuse of teens and technology can kind of lend into something else called gambling use disorder. Mike, how are you today?
I'm well. Thank you. Thank you, Yvonne, for having me on here today. So I know we only got 30 minutes, so I'll give you the highlights. I just left Kutztown Area Middle School, sixth grade. So depending on their birth dates, 10, 11, 12, somewhere in there. And the importance of the Teens and Technology Program, which is a two-part series, is one is the digital citizenship. The idea, and I start off, when I was in sixth grade, my phone was on a table with a cord that I shared with mom and dad and my baby sister. Mm-hmm. You know, when I say that, does anyone know what that is? Well, they all are, you know, of course we do, pal. You know, because, you know, people, young people are growing up with cell phones that they have privacy. They don't have to worry about sharing them with their parents, even though they may pay the bill, most likely probably do pay the bill. But the fact is that every time they're online, social media, gaming, texting, and the like, there is a digital footprint that really doesn't go away. And you know, I'm just amazed of, you know, the impact that might have, because, you know, even as adults, you know, you go for another job, future employers are looking at your social media digital footprint.
Absolutely.
And they're bringing that stuff up. So
absolutely.
That's the first part of the teens and technology. The second part is how gaming and gambling are in the same area, because the short definition of gambling is risking something of value, you know, taking a bet and risking something of value. And that value in a casino or lottery, it's pretty clear, it's money. In gaming, not only is it money because you need to buy the app, you buy the upgrades, but you're risking your non-renewable resource of time. Time and money for a 11-year-old are huge because they have limited money, even though mom and dad or grandparents give them so much, it's limited, like all of us. But we're all equal in that we only have 24 hours in any day, and you can only spend time. You cannot save it up for tomorrow. So those ideas that you have 8 hours of sleep, 8 hours in school, 8 hours to kind of do what you want, you know, the cell phones, and this is a new one for me, it's only about 6 months old, this one for the first time has that screen time activity. So I asked the kids, oh, well, how long? Well, you know, 2 hours, 3 hours, 5 hours, 6 hours. You know, you only have 8 hours extra time when you do your homework. You know what I think? So the time and money piece for the gaming, that you're making a bet on something and you're losing time, which is a non-renewable resource.
So I hear you, Mike, in terms of saying time as a non, you know, refundable resource, if you will. But what if youth are saying, but I'm able to, you know, connect with my friends. Mm-hmm. We're playing a game together. We happen to be chit-chatting at the same time. Mm-hmm. Isn't that, if it's time that you're speaking of, that's valuable time for me. But we, you know, in terms mm-hmm. of how do you respond to that if some kid in the classroom is saying, but these are the benefits for me.
So all through our presentation, and we have a presentation that's also kids and technology, which is a single session. And basically the programs are very parallel. It just, they're just a little bit younger. But it's always about the balance. You know, the Council on Chemical Abuse, we're not for or against gambling or gaming. Most people do not run into a problem. However, some people do run into a problem. So yeah, this is designed for entertainment. So if you're an adult and you have resources to gamble, you know, as long as you know that the house always wins and that this money is entertainment money, don't expect it back. If you get it back, great, good for you. If you don't, this is entertainment, like going to see the Eagles or the Philadelphia Phillies or your favorite sports team. It's you know, it's good time to connect with your friends and your buddies and share ideas. But if you're spending 7 hours and you only have 8 hours to do your homework and do other things, you know, it's important to have a balance. And so at this presentation, I'll ask the students, like, what do you do offline? Okay, you're entitled to game. You know, it's, you know, good use of your time and all that. Research has shown that. But what are you going to do offline? And I know one student says, I'm going to touch grass. He's going to play sports. He's going to run around the field. And today, it's well into the 60s, well above the average temperature. And I said, are you Kutztown Cougars going to go out there and play? Yeah, we're going to go play basketball. We're going to do this. Well, that's good. You know, so it's all about the balance.
Yeah. And I appreciate you talking about the balance. And I think this is a great conversation that parents should be hearing as well, because sometimes there's the idea that the social media sites are, you know, kind of keeping our young people entertained. Mm-hmm. If they're not outside necessarily in the quote unquote streets, and I know that they're home and I know that they're home safe, that's not necessarily the case if you're not closely monitoring which sites are they visiting. And I'm just wondering if you could have a talk a little bit about how sometimes those sites There's a monetary value to it because sometimes if you're trying to upgrade the game and you need, you know, money to do that, you're tending to, and say, you know, you got access to mom and dad's credit card, there you go. And by also the other thing too is, you know, you're connecting with people to play games. Some of them very well may not be your friends. They may be some folks that are into the game as well, but you don't necessarily know them.
Mm-hmm. Yes, yeah, so the monitoring, and this is a good education for the parents, and I need to be reminded of the fact that the human brain is not fully developed until a person's about 25 years old. So I'm talking to 11-year-olds here. So the front part of your brain, the decision-making, the executive function, is not fully developed until you're 25. So these, frankly, children are well in the developmental stage. And so now they're online. Some of this will be very good for them. However, you have predators online. You have the thieves who are trying to get passwords, trying to get personal information, trying to meet up and do illegal events. So it's very important for parents, caregivers, grandparents, as we were saying today, it could sound trusted adults in the picture, whether that's a teacher or a school counselor or the school nurse or a pastor or some type of spiritual counselor, to be aware that there are some pitfalls there.
And we also can also throw in there, if you don't mind, if you talk about peer pressure, because sometimes there is with the developing brain, and youth are really looking to part of their social network is to expand it and make friends. The likelihood of youth involved in peer pressure to say, oh, let's go to your house and let's play this game. And oh, by the way, here's access to a credit card. Let's kind of, you know, buy this game so that we can play longer, and wanting to please our friends. Mm-hmm. We don't want to say no. We want to be part of the crowd of how influential peer pressure can help make some of those not so good decisions.
Yes, yeah, and I definitely agree with that, Yvonne, that peer pressure is a big part. And you know, we shift that. When we have peer pressure, we talk about that in the program. It's the idea, if it doesn't feel right, trust an adult. And I mentioned to him, I said, listen, I wasn't born old. I was your age. And so adults are everywhere. You can't get rid of us. You know, they're in the bathroom, they're in the kitchen, they're in the living room, they're at school, they're, you know, at the soccer field, they're at church, we're everywhere. So, you know, reach out to us. And, you know, parents have a responsibility. We're the adults. As parents need to be monitoring this activity. And I know that, you know, I'll raise, how much screen time? What's your limit? You know, a couple kids said an hour a day, 2 hours a day, 3 hours a day. One student said, unlimited. Well, a little bit concerned there that at least in that class, at least one person was willing to admit that, you know, the sky's the limit. They could, 3 o'clock in the morning, they could be in their bedroom under the covers still playing a game with who knows what. And so the adults have a responsibility here. Peer pressure is great.
I find that fascinating that young folks are willing to have this conversation. And I think sometimes caregivers and parents probably feel that, how do I have that conversation? How to initiate that conversation without sounding like I am being a nag, if you will. But it sounds like when you're having these conversations in the classroom, the youth are very forthcoming. They're very forthcoming because you're forthcoming with information. And so in responding to that, I'm just wondering if, do you have any thoughts about what is the best way to bring this topic up? Now, they know that you're in the classroom as part of this, mm-hmm. but if someone's at home with a caregiver or someone that is, a parent, how might these conversations go? We seize the moment over dinner time? Do we, you know, sometimes you hear, you know, some youth report, as soon as I get into the house, my phone goes into a basket until I've done my homework, and then I can retrieve it.
Yeah, that's a perfect example of where I would go with this. So as adults, we're in charge. We need to set the boundaries from the door. So one of the students said today that none of these at the dinner table. Good for those parents or caregivers, because not everyone has the nuclear mom and dad. There's single parent homes. A lot more people have blended families. They've remarried, have children from both relationships previously. And so it can be difficult. Mm-hmm. It can be difficult. You know, because when I grew up, it seemed like everyone was married, but that's not the case now. You have, you know, family members, grandparents raising children. And so, you know, from day one, the suggestion is, you know, at least from my experience, talking to 11-year-olds particularly, if they have access to this, which most of them do, because I asked them, how many, you know what that is? How many have, well, you know, 80-90% have cell phones? This one student said, oh yeah, I've had a cell phone since I'm 8 years old. Well, before you even let them have it, you got to set the boundaries, and you need to be the adult and enforce the boundaries, whatever they are. And if they disobey, ground it, mm-hmm. something, there has to be consequences. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, there will be problems. Mm-hmm. There will be problems. And we're setting our children up to gamble, because the idea of that gambling is taking a risk for something important and knowing full well that on these games they have what's called a loot box, and sometimes you get a banana or sometimes you get $1 million or whatever.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
Sometimes you get something that you don't really want, but sometimes you get really what you want. It's like, yeah, this is great. Mm-hmm. And that's gambling.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes you rub off the lottery ticket, but you pull the handle, you get nothing. Sometimes, oh, wow, $1,000, yay! You know, so that's periodic winning,
yeah.
But the house always wins.
Yeah, and I appreciate what you talked about in the way of saying, you know, there are times that it's very beneficial. You can win something, and what happens is that triggers the brain to say, this feels really good, mm-hmm. and I want to feel this way all the time. And so you kind of go back to that until you actually have that experience again. And that's really kind of some of the characteristics that are leading into the opportunity for young people to get engaged in problem gambling. And I'm just wondering if you can talk a little bit about that in the way of youth who might spend an exorbitant amount of time. Sometimes it starts off as games, mm-hmm. but then they have the opportunity to maybe do a soft bet, or maybe there's, you know, a competition between on social media, playing a game and the winner wins, you know, $2 or $3. It sometimes starts out small, but the ongoing reward mm-hmm. allows that for something greater. And if you could talk about a little bit about that in terms of problem gambling, the propensity to lead to problem gambling.
Yes. So when I'm in the classrooms, and I've been lucky enough to be in Brandywine, in Exeter, in Wilson, and Kutztown today. Next week will be Why Missing, and the message will always be the same, that gaming is setting up young people to gamble. And in the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania, casino gambling is legal and robust because of the tax income mm-hmm. that the state receives.
Mm-hmm.
So the Pennsylvania casinos in 2022, $5 billion in 1 year. That's in 2022, $5 billion with a B, billion dollars. Epic Games, Fortnite, our friends who made that Fortnite and other games, $18 million up until 2022. Billion with a B. So big industry. So a lot of smart people have been thinking about how we can classical conditioning and positive reinforcement to the brain, to the dopamine, that I like it and I want to have continuous play. So it starts as all those liking the photos and comments and the continuous feed, the 24/7 availability. It's not like you can only go to the social media from 9 to 5. You can go on social media 24/7. And so that sets it up that I really like it, I want to do it. And now with the sports betting and the online betting, which just is the last few years, which came in with the truck stops and the mini casinos, if you will, at Morgantown's, the closest mini casinos, they expanded that sports betting. So sports are all year round, and it just really seems like they're getting longer. Baseball's going to start in a couple of weeks in March, and depending on how many games the World Series goes into November. You know, basketball starts in the fall, and it seems like, you know, it almost goes to the 4th of July.
Yeah.
So, you know, all that sports betting is now available to the citizens as long as you're over 21. Not only just win-lose, but how many pitchers are thrown, how long the national anthem will take, how many runs scored, how many strikeouts. I mean, continuous online play. So that whole that gaming business and the whole the popularity of sports, very legal, very socially acceptable. Mm-hmm. You know, so we're young people are in the rooms chatting about different things. I mean, hey, you know, the Phillies look good the last couple of years. So there's a lot of, there's a couple of kids with Philly stuff on. So there's a lot of chatter about the sports. So. Yeah.
And I appreciate you talking about the age. The minimum age is 21, but there's also the likelihood of young people under the age of 21 gaining access to somehow betting through family and friends.
Right.
Right?
I can bet with my buddy at 10 years old, yeah.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
And go so, Eagles. Yeah,
so,
right.
So we want to be mindful to share with adults that you want to be careful not to engage if it's a younger person under the age of 21, because again, that brain is still developing. And
right.
So sometimes, you know, in the most innocent way, family members are calling somebody, a little one over, saying, what do you think? And, you know, if I win, I'll split the winnings with you, or I'll give you $5 or something. But what that can propel for that young person to think about, you know, if they're in the midst of being able to choose picks, and then there's nothing stopping them from going to their friends and saying, I bet you, and those type of things, and
right.
how all of those things can just really engulf and become mammoth to the point whereby now you're having young people, 10, 12, 15, and it happens. We know about it, that they're gambling, and they're gambling substantial, you know, whether it's their new purchase of Nike shoes or whether it's their, you know, their game system or something.
Mm-hmm.
But those things can really come with consequences on the back end.
Right. You know, so one of the kids today said, oh, yeah, my, you know, what's important to you? Yeah, my jewelry, you know, like. So there's a lot of options there. So definitely 18, lottery, 21, casinos, sports betting. But the fact is, we don't want to encourage the parents. You just don't know how your young ones are going to react. You go to the supermarket, you have the lottery, the rub off, the scratch off. You know, this is not a good idea. These are not stocking stuffers. They're made for 18 and older for a reason.
But and there's really nothing, Mike. I don't mean to cut you off, but there's really nothing. When those machines are in the grocery store, I don't see people monitoring. There's nobody standing by that machine saying, show me your ID. And so there's really nothing stopping a 15 or 16-year-old from going in there.
You're right.
And getting those scratch-offs. Particularly if they win, they can just give an adult some, you know, say, here, can you go cash this in for me? And so
right.
We just have to be mindful
yes.
of our young people, particularly as they grow and develop, and that brain
yep.
really sends those signals about, this is powerful,
right.
this is fun, let's do this again.
Yep. Yeah, yeah.
Mm-hmm. And so I, you know, as you mentioned, the two different programs, and one is really towards the more elementary, and the other one is for middle school. Are you hearing from young people in terms of their own disclosure of losses that they've experienced? Have they had to, if they gambled to the extent that they've lost something, only to find, you know, with the desire to kind of get that back?
Well, what I heard in several classes today at Kutztown is the loss of time. When they see Fortnite, you know, we have a screen that just shows rewards and it has pictures of Fortnite activity. I can see it because I'm in the front of the classroom. Big smiles, eyes wide open. So I see a loss of time. We have another slide that has a student under the covers and playing a game that looks like it is 3 o'clock in the morning or something like that. And I said, can anyone relate to that? Oh yeah, I can relate to that. So I see a lot of loss of time. I talk to the teachers when I'm in these programs, and they said, yeah, this one kid came in falling asleep during first period. And the teacher said, well, did you get any sleep last night? Well, no, I was playing Fortnite, blah, 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 blah. And so, you know, they call the parents, and the parents say, well, you know, I got the baby, I'm working late, and this, well, you still have this 11-year-old, you got to take care of the 11-year-old too, because he's falling asleep in class. That's not good for him. So again, you know, people are busy, the blended families, there's a lot of responsibilities, working, you know, all kinds of shifts, you know, can understand it. So not so much losing money, that is disclosure. Mm-hmm. But when I started, I've been with the council now, it's been 12 years. I can't believe the time has gone fine. When we started, we had a lot more data coming out of Canada, because in the British Empire, you know, gambling is legal, and there was more research done. And so what happens here is grandmom gives grandson a $50 gift card, you know, a Visa gift card, you know, whatever, MasterCard. You can go to the supermarket or the pharmacy, you know, and buy a gift card. Well, then the youth, they could go online and gamble, really gamble. And so, of course, you know, you have those young people who would actually steal credit card numbers and whatnot, you know, type of thing. But that was like the first, you know, they create an account with a gift card. And if there's not a lot of checks and balance, they're in.
Mm-hmm. And I, you know, I appreciate you talking about the young person who kind of sat up all night. And what parents need to understand is not only is your child then suffering in school with missed, you know, they might miss important information that's critical to their own education, but that there is something also that's called deprivation of sleep, which actually causes brain fog. And so the retention is limited as well. And so why we really support the importance of young people getting their rest, getting the, you know, three meals a day, the exercise that they need to help with their own, you know, personal development, physically as well as, you know, developing from a social perspective as well. And then, you know, we talk about, is there any way that you suggest, recommend for parents to approach, you know, how do you go from unlimited hours to now with this new piece of information saying, you know, you have some valid points here that you're talking about today, let's kind of scale it back.
And that's a very good point, the scaling it back. Okay, so now we have unlimited. Let's start 4 hours, and let's see how that works. We want to monitor your grades. We give you a budget. So, yeah, we can understand you want to level up, and you want to talk to your buddies. You want to have that peer support, that peer pressure. You know, all my good buddies are doing this. So start somewhere and make some adjustments from there. But unlimited is just simply not a good idea because these are young minds.
And you know, I think it's important that we understand that we have to be willing to, young people look to us for those guidance.
Yes.
They look to us for those limitations. Because again, that developing brain, they don't have the reference mm-hmm. That we do, you know, in terms of just kind of saying, know when to know when and know what's the next right thing. Young mm-hmm. people really look for adults to kind of guide them to say,
absolutely right.
2 hours of this, it's now time to do that, get ready for bed, X,
right.
Y, and Z. And so you mentioned that you are in several different school districts. Are you in others? Are you in the Reading School District? Are you in Antietam, et cetera? How does that work in terms of where you're at?
I'm part-time, so I've been given certain assignments. We have several full-time people that are in other school districts, and that we have other programs with the Council of Chemical Abuse. Vaping, too good for drugs, marijuana, you know, that there are other programs in addition to the teens and technology. But I do this part-time, so my next assignment is in Why I'm Missing.
Wonderful. And I also need to just kind of put a little plug in that you're very knowledgeable because you also do some community awareness regarding problem gambling, with providing information about problem gambling as it relates to individuals, maybe adults, and where they can go to get additional resources and find out the help that they need as well.
Yeah, so March is Problem Gambling Awareness Month. And 1-800-PROBLEM-GAMBLER would be the first resource I would suggest to anyone who's struggling with any, them or their families, any information. 1-800-PROBLEM-GAMBLER.
Well, you, as always, Mike, are a wealth of information. I really appreciate your expertise that you brought today.
Thank you.
I want to encourage our home viewers, if you have any questions regarding the services available at the Council on Chemical Abuse, please give us a call, 610-376-8669, or visit our website at COCA Berks, that's COCABERKS.org. In the meantime, we thank you for joining us. This is the Council on Chemical Abuse, Drug and Alcohol Update. We wish you well. Be safe. Till next time.
All right.
The Council on Chemical Abuse, Drug and Alcohol Update on BCTV is supported by the Council on Chemical Abuse.